Good evening, everyone. Let me call to order our Lynnwood City Council business meeting for this evening, Monday, January 25th, 2017. And if you would, Councilmember Hurst, would you lead us in the flag salute?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Can we have the roll call, please? Here.
Council President Goodwin?
Present.
Council Vice President Ross?
Here.
Councilmember Boyer?
Here.
Excuse me, Councilmember Cotton?
Here.
Councilmember Sessions?
Here.
Councilmember Sutton?
Here.
Councilmember Hurst?
Here.
Council's President, Mayor?
Thank you. Moving on to item 30, Councilmember Cotton, would you do the approval of the minutes, please?
Absolutely. I would move the approval of the following meeting minutes. Item 30A, the business meeting from December 12, 2016, and item 30B, business meeting from January 9, 2017.
Second, sorry.
Thank you. Are there any corrections or amendments to our minutes? All right, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposition? So moved. Let's see, I think I have a few messages this evening. We're on item 40. It's been busy. So January 12th went to the community grand opening of Lindell Elementary School. And I would certainly like to extend my congratulations to the principal, Chris Fulford, and the superintendent, McDuffie, and the school board on the opening. It's a beautiful school, and our community and our children definitely deserve it. My daughter actually went to that school, but not that school. The school she went to had the blue cinder blocks. It's a beautiful school. I would go down and visit it. It's very exciting. Then on Friday the 13th, I attended the annual Korean American Day celebration along with the council members Session and Sutton and our intergovernmental liaison, Gina Israel. And we heard from the keynote speaker, who's recently elected Lieutenant Governor Cyrus Habib. And we saw many performances, and there was, 100 essays that were written as a competition, and our local teen, Sea Choi, was the junior at Lynnwood High School, and she won the Graham Prize Scholarship. Yep, that was statewide, so we're very proud of her. And then on the 18th, the AWC Mayor's Exchange, Legislative Action Days, and I went with City Administrator Art Siniza, and again, Gina Israel. We were down in Olympia, and it was just really great to connect with our local mayors, actually state mayors. There was about 90 cities represented, I think, and our city leaders, and how we can effectively work with our legislators during the upcoming session. This past Thursday, the Regional Fire Authority Planning Committee hosted our first community open house at our local fire station. We had about 25 attendees in total, but if you missed it, we're hosting another open house this coming Wednesday evening from 6 to 7:30 at Station 21, which is the Martha Lake Fire Station, and I encourage you all to stop by. And lastly, I'm sure you'll hear more about this from Councilmember Sessions, but I was honored to be a guest judge at this past Friday night for the first Lynnwood Idol Sing Loud and Proud, and it was one of the most fabulous things I've ever been to. So thank you and your family for putting that on. It was really, really a special evening. So let's see, moving on to item 50, citizen comments and communications. I'm supposed to start with the sheet, but nobody's signed up. Anyone like to speak this evening? Mr. Heichel?
Good evening, Council, Mayor. Having attended the Regional Fire Authority meeting, many of them, including today's meeting, the question of additional taxes for Lynnwood property owners, while fire district property owners would see no increase, and the realization at today's meeting that Lynnwood would lose control of the administration, finances, and level of service to a board that would only have one or perhaps two members at most representing Lynnwood. It confirms my opinion that original fire authority is a lose-lose proposition for Lynnwood, for the citizens, and for the property owners. With the resignation of Chief Cockrum, our fire chief, and a replacement of the fire chief with the assistant fire chief of the fire district, it again draws our attention to the fact that the control of the Lynnwood Fire Department is slipping away. Secondly, I'm sorry to see the elimination of the neighborhood section from the Diversity Commission. We need, and council members have called over time, for organizing our neighborhoods so the city can more effectively communicate with residents. The lack of that communication was quite evident at last week's turnout for the RFA open house. Other than electeds, staff, a number of former council members, only a handful, maybe only five new faces, showed up out of the 36,000 residents of the city. Third, tonight, in the ordinance on your agenda to change regulation of board and commissions, one thing I'm concerned about is limiting volunteers to a maximum of two terms. These terms are for 3 or 4 years, depending on the board. So after 6 or 8 years, the board or commission member is thrown off. There's no possibility of anyone having a history of what went before if they're gone in 6 or 8 years. Even staff leaving the city after a few years and elected officials changing every 4 to 8 years, it's left us with no history of why we have policies and why they were adopted. This was evident last week at your work meeting when no one knew when the police and fire chief were placed under civil service. There was no place on your work agenda for a citizen who knows the story to add to your knowledge. The late Marie Little served many years as an historian in town. She knew much of the history of the city, but if she were appointed to the History and Heritage Board under these new rules, she could only serve 6 years. Does that make sense? History needs its historians. And I can tell you, the introduction of civil service to the police chief originally and then eventually to the fire chief started back in the late 1960s, not 12 years ago. And it was because the mayor, Mayor Alkire, had fired the chief of police. And while he was out of town on a business trip, the Mayor Pro Tem rehired the police chief and put the had the council put the police chief under civil service, so when the mayor came back into town, he couldn't fire him again. That's the history of it. It goes on a little further that chief of police eventually had to leave office because he had stolen property out of the police property room and eventually did leave the police force. But there's a lot of history that you could learn if you listen to people who have been around a while. Thanks.
Thank you. Are there others who'd like to speak this evening? All right. So we will move on with our presentations and proclamations, item 60. We have two proclamations and a resolution. The first proclamation is for Black History Month, and Councilmember Sutton, are you reading that?
Yes.
Thank you very much.
From here?
Is anybody here to accept it? From here is fine then.
Okay. Thank you. It's my honor. Proclamation, City of Lynnwood, recognition of Black History Month. Whereas Negro History Week was created by Dr. Carter G. Woodson in 1926 and later became known as Black History Month or National African American History Month. And whereas Black History Month is an annual celebration of achievements by Black Americans and a time for recognizing the central role of African Americans in the United States history. And whereas African Americans have played a significant role in the history of Washington State's economy, culture, spiritual, and political development, and whereas much of Lynnwood's honor, strength, and distinction can be attributed to the diversity of cultures and traditions that are celebrated by our residents. And whereas the City of Lynnwood recognizes the month of February as Black History Month, a time in which all Americans are encouraged to reflect on past successes and challenges of African Americans and to look to the future to improve society so that we live up to the ideals of freedom, equity, justice. And now, therefore, it be resolved that we, Mayor Nicholas Smith and the Lynnwood City Council, proclaim February as Black History Month, and we call upon public officials, educators, businesses, volunteers, and all people of Lynnwood to join us in celebrating the great contributions of African Americans to our city, state, and our union. Signed, Nicholas Smith, Mayor, and Benjamin Goodman, City Council President, January 23, 2017. Thank you.
And would you like to move for council to confirm the proclamation?
And I'll second that. If you'll move it.
Oh, I'm sorry. I never knew I had to do that.
We don't have to.
You don't have to.
But you'd love to.
But please
I am pleased to. Thank you.
And I'll second that.
Thank you, Ruth. Wow, that's a new twist for me.
Always learning. And all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Thank you very much. Our second proclamation is Wear Red Day.
Hey.
Council Vice President Ross.
To be read by someone wearing red.
Wearing red.
Isn't that amazing?
You coordinate yourself well.
Beth told me I had to.
Oh, Beth tells a lot of us what.
This is a proclamation of the City of Lynnwood to recognize National Wear Red Day. The font in this is about 4 points, so if I mess up, you'll know why. Whereas heart disease and stroke kill 1 in 3 women in the United States, yet 80% of cardiac events may be prevented. And whereas cardiovascular diseases and stroke kill 1 woman every 80 seconds in the United States, and an estimated 44 million women in the U.S. are affected by cardiovascular disease. And whereas 90% of women have 1 or more risk factors for developing heart disease, yet only 1 in 5 American women believe that heart disease is her greatest health threat. Whereas women comprise only 24% of participants in all health-related studies. And whereas women are less likely to call 911 for themselves when experiencing symptoms of a heart attack than they are if someone else were having a heart attack. And whereas only 13% of African American women and 15% of Hispanic women know that heart disease is their greatest health risk, along with 18% of Caucasian women. And whereas women involved with the American Heart Association Go Red for Women movement live healthier lives and nearly 90% have made at least 1 healthy behavior change. And whereas Go Red for Women encourages women to take charge of their health and schedule a well woman visit to learn about health status and risk for diseases. And whereas Go Red for Women is asking all Americans to go red by wearing red and speaking red. Get your numbers. Ask your doctor to check your blood pressure, cholesterol, and glucose. Own your lifestyle. Stop smoking, lose weight, be physically active, and eat healthy. Raise your voice. Advocate for more women-related research and education. Educate your family. Make healthy food choices for your family. Teach kids the importance of staying active. And donate. Show your support with a donation of time or money. Now, therefore, be it resolved that we, the Mayor and City Council of the City of Lynnwood, recognize the importance of the ongoing fight against heart disease and stroke, do hereby proclaim Friday, February 3rd, 2017, to be National Wear Red Day in Lynnwood and urge all citizens to show their support for women and the fight against heart disease by commemorating this day by wearing of the color red. By increasing awareness, speaking up about heart disease, and empowering women to reduce their risk for cardiovascular disease, we can save thousands of lives each year. Signed, Nicholas Smith, Mayor, and Benjamin Goodwin, City Council President, January 23, 2017. And I would move the council concur.
Second.
And all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Thank you. At 60. C, we now have a resolution. This is a resolution for us to be a safe, welcoming, and equitable community for all. And I get to read this, and I'm just wondering if those who are here to receive this resolution wouldn't mind coming forward, because I know we have members of our Communities of Color and Lynnwood Police Relations Task Force and their children, at least one, Miss Penelope. These are some of the members of a task force that we put together with Councilmember Boyer. What's it been, almost 3 months ago now?
September.
In September. And we've had a group of 16 to 20 people meeting every other week with our Lynnwood police, talking about how we can make Lynnwood a safe and welcoming community. And so I want to thank you, those of you who are here and those of you who are not, for being concerned citizens, wanting to work with the city, and being our trusted messengers. So this resolution is for our city, and I'm also happy to say that I met with the South End mayors, and Everett's been involved in the conversation too with regard to putting forward these resolutions. And so they're all looking relatively similar, so that we have a regional effort and not just city by city. Here it is, resolution number 2017-03, a resolution of the City of Lynnwood, Washington, reaffirming our city commitment to be a safe, welcoming, and equitable community for all. Whereas Lynnwood is a city with great diversity that includes racial, ethnic, socioeconomic status, age, sexual orientation, gender identification, country of origin, veteran status, differently abled, as well as a diversity of thought, religion, workforce, and marketplace. And whereas in Lynnwood, all members of our community that choose to live here peacefully have the right to be treated fairly and to live their lives with dignity, free from discrimination or targeting based on their race, religion, country of origin, or other identity. And whereas the best way to engage underserved and underrepresented communities with local government is through creating trusting relationships built upon mutual respect and understanding. And whereas the City of Lynnwood understands that a healthy city is one in which all members of the community have an equity-based opportunity to access city services, participate in the public process, and feel safe and welcome in their community. And whereas the City of Lynnwood is committed to being pro-equity in city practices and governance through our actions, processes, and decisions. And whereas in the City of Lynnwood, elected officials have a duty to serve all members of our community and protect their basic human rights, ensure their safety and social well-being. And whereas we strongly condemn acts of hate, violence, intimidation, harassment, or any other acts that are based on age, race, ethnicity, national origin, immigration status, gender identity, ability, faith, housing status, sexual orientation, economic status, or other social status. And therefore, the City Council of the City of Lynnwood, Washington, do resolve as follows. The City Council, Mayor, and the police chief added his name to this resolution, who's ill tonight and couldn't be here, he apologizes, are committed to making Lynnwood a safe, welcoming, and equitable community for everyone that lives, works, plays, does business, goes to school, or visits our city. The City Council, Mayor, and police chief are committed to standing together with the people of Lynnwood in opposing hate, violence, and acts of intolerance committed against our community members. The City Council, Mayor, and Police Chief are committed to continuing our pro-equity work, reaching out and connecting with our community members to ensure that our programs are accessible and open to all individuals. Resolved by the City Council of the City of Lynnwood, Washington, this 23rd day of January 2017. And I know that Ms. Julie would like to have a photo op with all of us. And Council President Boyer.
Your Honor, I move the passage of this resolution.
Second.
Thank you. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Thank you. Come, picture with us. And anyone else who'd like to be in the picture who believes in what we just read.
Probably need to scooch in a little, guys.
Are we doing this right?
I don't know.
I don't know the hole here.
The 32nd District Democrats have also passed a similar.
Excellent, excellent. You guys want to come up? Chris, Lauren? Van, Art?
Got us all?
All right.
Art, come on, Art.
Come on, Art.
Come on.
Come on.
Lauren. Small but friendly.
All of us.
Isn't that right?
Okay, perfect.
Thank you.
Thank you, Julie.
Thank you all.
Thank you.
I don't know if I'm speaking out of turn here.
You, please go to the microphone. Introduce yourself.
First of all, I just wanted to commend Mayor Smith for proposing this resolution, and also very thankful to Interim Chief Tom Davis for adding his signature, especially in the current times where we're seeing a lot of things on TV and even at the inauguration where 200 people were arrested. They were protesting the inauguration in a very savage way. So I'm glad that this resolution has been passed, and I commend all the council members for doing that, and because the part of the safety for the citizens of Lynnwood is the most important part, I think, of this resolution. Thank you.
Thank you, Juan. And as Mr. Heichel was coming forward, he also informed us that the 32nd Democrats have also passed a similar resolution. Thank you for sharing that. Are there any written communications, petitions? Well, all right, we'll move on to 80. We'll start with Councilmember Sessions with our council comments and announcements.
Thank you. All right. First, I'd like to briefly talk about a week ago Sunday, we had an incident a lot of people probably heard about at the mall where a man was stabbed at the mall in the food court. And the word spread quickly around the mall that it potentially was an active shooter incident. Understandably, because active shooter is unfortunately more of a reality these days, you can see why that has spread. With that said, it was incorrect information, and the suspect and the scene was dealt with very quickly. But with that said, not only did we have a great response from our Lynnwood Police Department on the ground, I wanted to even more so mention one of the reasons why the scene and the a lot of employees and people who work at the mall were de-escalated was because of the quick communication Lynnwood Police Department did over Twitter. And if you don't already follow Lynnwood Police Department over Twitter, I hope that you do for reasons like this. They were able to get accurate updates out very quickly, actually even quicker than most media even knew about the incident happening at all. And you know, there's not a way to stop people from using social networking in incidents like this, and it's going to get worse, not better. And so I'm so glad that our police department is getting in the game of doing that so that we can have an accurate and updates on different incidents like that. And in this case, it was the quickest updates from the moments I heard about it. And that moment I heard about it wasn't very long after it happened. Lynnwood Police had updates up there very quickly. Thank you for that. And I'm glad that nobody was badly hurt or that it was worse. So grateful for that. Also, I was part of the Public Facilities District. I'm the Public Facilities District this year. Liaison for the council, and that's the group that covers this Lynnwood Convention Center as well. And I'm happy to report that they had another great year. Convention centers aren't really made and expected to make money, but our Lynnwood Convention Center has made money again which is just really good news for our community and for the businesses around as well. And then also, as the mayor said, we had our first Lynnwood Idol, Sing Loud and Proud. My family was coordinating that, particularly my oldest daughter, and this was a singing competition for young adults with disabilities, and it was better than I could expect. And those kids, they're not kids, they're young adults, just stepped it up, and they were so warm and supportive, encouraging of each other. It was so heartwarming. Mayor Smith was a judge. Thank you. We also had two other employees, my husband Keith Sessions, Lynnwood Fire Captain, and also Sergeant Cole Langdon, and then also Edmond School District Superintendent Chris McDuffie, and local vocal talent Joan Penny as well, all there as our distinguished judges, and their words were just really meaningful to them. And if you haven't seen it, go ahead and look at the Lynnwood Today did a beautiful feature on it as well, and the pictures are really, really lovely. So hopefully we can do that again next year. And I would also just like to say thank you to the support of the Alderwood Community Church for donating their space for this, and their stage and their audio and visual for this event, and also award services. They donated all of our awards, trophies, and medals for this, and Chick-fil-A and Fred Meyer as well. Thank you.
Thank you. So you want to go there? No. Councilmember Cotton.
Sitting back, because I don't know which order we go in these days.
You never will.
I know.
I gotta keep you on your toes.
That's all right. There's got to be some excitement these evenings, right? What a time to be alive. I tell you what, there is just a lot going on in our city and in our region, and a lot of positive things. Couple things, I just use this opportunity to just kind of inform people what we know, since we're kind of close to a lot of things. One of the things that I'd like to thank Director Sordell of our Parks and Recreations and Cultural Arts Department. He distributed the Washington State Department of Health completed a study regarding crumb rubber and its links to cancer, and determined that there was no link between cancer and crumb rubber for AstroTurf or artificial turf for fields. So they are continuing to monitor that. However, that study is out there, so if you want to be more informed about that, you can read up on that. Also, I'd like to take a moment to thank our Human Services Commission. If you get an opportunity on the city website, is their community needs assessment. I actually read through the thing the other night. It was my leisurely reading. But the one thing that stood out to me was it's very clear to me that we're doing a lot of things really well. But three things that stood out to me that are real needs that we are not taking care of right now are shelter, mental health, and chemical dependency and counseling are really what our community is telling us they need. The mayor already mentioned this, but there's going to be another RFA public open house this Wednesday. Please come. It's a kid-friendly environment. My daughter went to the last one. She's got a really big personality, but she was ecstatic to leave with a lot of swag. So there are firefighter hats and stickers and a coloring book, so she was very excited about that. And then two last items here. Excited to announce that there will be an off-leash dog park opening February 11th. Lynnwood's first at Lyndale Park, kind of just west of the skate park. So that will be, there'll be a grand opening on February 11th from 10 a.m. to 11 a.m. That's a Saturday. So that's very exciting for all you people out there with fur children. And then lastly, I just kind of like to just touch on what a great police force we have here in Lynnwood. I think it's been studied several ways, and the reports and studies always find that we really have a best in class police force. Excellently trained, professional, responds with restraint and professionalism and compassion in every instance. And so I just want to thank them for their service and let our community know that we're really blessed in that regard. So, and that'll be all for me. Thank you.
Councilmember Boyer.
Thank you, Your Honor, and I want to concur with my colleague, Mr. Cotton. We really do have a fine police force, and we don't always do a good job of letting folks know the good things that they do. In fact, there was an internal set of internal emails today from Chief Tom Davis giving some of us the story of how one citizen had responded to the fact that three police officers came and helped him in a crisis by praising those officers to the skies and saying, you know, what a significant difference they had made in his life. And for reasons of confidentiality, we're not going to be able to print that that thank you letter, but it sure was heartwarming to see it. Also, Councilmember Cotton mentioned that one of our great needs in Lynnwood, as perceived by our residents, is for shelter for homeless folk. And just a reminder that many, many, many in the faith community are doing everything they can to help remedy that situation. I think I mentioned last meeting that we had council member comments that there is now a five-person tent village called Shepherd's Village at Good Shepherd Baptist Church. These are folks are all students from Edmonds Community College who were trying to go to school and better their lives while having to find a place to live every night, a place to sleep every night. And thanks to Reverend Dr. Gene Kim of Presbyterian Church USA and Maplewood Presbyterian Church and her Gene Kim Foundation, we now have a safe, secure, stable place for these five folks to live on the campus at Good Shepherd. Also happening at Good Shepherd tomorrow is the YWCA's annual event surrounding the point-in-time count of homelessness. This is the point-in-time count is a federal program trying to capture information about the homeless population around our nation. And here in South Snohomish County, the YWCA has been in charge of doing that count for several years. And they, some years ago, added an event to bring homeless folks together, give them some hot food and hot beverages, get them some survival supplies that they need, get them in touch with social services they need, such as mental health services and addiction services. So those sorts of things are going on, and it's not just at Good Shepherd Baptist either. So many of the churches and communities of faith in Lynnwood and Edmonds and Mount Lake Terrace have banded together over the years to do many important works for this very vulnerable population. And if you are watching or hearing this and you belong to a community of faith and you don't know whether your faith leaders are participating in these programs, I encourage you to ask them and encourage them to get involved. Thank you.
Thank you. Councilmember Hurst.
Thank you. Just briefly, because I'm chair of the FAR RFA committee for this council, I too will like to remind you about the RFA open house that's on Wednesday of this week at the Martha Lake Fire Station. And the address is 16819 13th Avenue West, Lynnwood, Washington. And that's another story. And I would just like to echo Councilmember Boyer. You know, there are a lot of neat people in this city that volunteer and work hard that really don't get recognized. And I would just suggest, even though I'm hesitant about term limits for council and boards, or commissions and boards, maybe even councils, that it does give an opportunity, though, for other citizens to participate in those commissions and boards. And, you know, instead of a limiting factor, maybe it's expanding that ability for citizens to volunteer. So it may be a good thing. And I think that's all I need to say. Thank you.
Councilmember Sutton.
Thank you very much. I just want to encourage the greater community, because I know that there are those that actually look at our tape from the city council meeting. You've heard tonight about the importance of volunteering and the opportunities, but I also want to tell you that if it hadn't been for me to get involved, when I came here in 2001, I was involved in a number of meetings that was held for the city, got to know the administration, got to know some of the employees. I don't think I'd be sitting here. So I'm just telling you that that will make your life in many ways. Giving to others will make you a better person. And I would like to think I'm growing better every day. So the other thing is that in order for you to be able to give a good vote one way or the other on the RFA that is pending, please, please attend these meetings. Please listen. Please ask if you don't know. Get the information right in order to help you make the best decision. Thank you.
Thank you. Vice President Ross.
Well, there's a lot on my mind, but I don't have anything to say.
Oh.
So I'm finished.
Okay. President Goodwin.
Fair enough. Thank you. There are two messages that I want to share. One has been shared briefly about the officers that helped one of our citizens. And there are some things that I took note of from the internal email that I would like to share. First, the person mentioned that he actually dealt with three police officers from Lynnwood. And he said the first one listened with an inclination of wanting to understand and assimilate the information with an impartiality that I can only be in awe of. He was gentle in his questioning and very accommodating and patient as shock had begun to set in during our speaking. Then he said the second officer was remarkably compassionate and empathetic. And then the last officer that he spoke of said, he stood by patiently as I wrote out my statement and provided me with clear, concise information as to how things would proceed from there. So our officers not only comforted and were empathetic, but they continued to give information and advice and help to this person that was struggling and having, you know, some issues at the time. The last thing that he says is I cannot say enough good about them. They are, in my opinion, the very standard by which their peers ought to be measured. So I want to commend our police department for the wonderful work that they do, for the training that they receive, and for the empathy that they share with each other and with our community. And secondly, there's an article that I've had sitting at my house for a while from a magazine that I had from a while back. And this article is titled, An Attitude of Gratitude, How Positive Thoughts Can Transform Your Life. And I thought about this because I believe his name was Juan, the gentleman that spoke a little earlier and expressed his gratitude for the way that the city of Lynnwood handles issues that come about. And I want us all to think about just this brief story. The author of this article writes, an example of someone who epitomizes this being an attitude of gratitude, is W. Mitchell, an inspiring man who was nearly killed in a blazing motorcycle accident that left him with burns on 65% of his body. Years later, he was paralyzed in a plane crash and is now confined to a wheelchair with a disfigured face and tiny stumps in the place of fingers. Yet he has chosen to embrace the positives of his situation and use it as a platform to inspire others. Now an international speaker, Mitchell passionately spreads the message of his book, It's Not What Happens to You, It's What You Do About It. He encourages us all by saying, before I was paralyzed, there were 10,000 things I could do. Now there are 9,000. I can either dwell on the 1,000 I've lost or focus on the 9,000 I have left. So I want to encourage us as a city and as a council to focus on those 9,000 things that we can do. There are changes that have been made in the council. There are changes that have been made in the country. And some of those things that we used to be able to do, we may not be able to, but we still have a lot that we can do and a lot that we have to be grateful for. So I want to encourage us to continue to work with those things that we have and continue to help and improve our city and help the citizens of Lynnwood. Thank you.
Thank you. Need a drink of water? We're moving on to item 90. This is business items and other matters. This is 90.1, our unanimous consent agenda, and Vice President Ross will be.
And now you know why I didn't have anything to say.
Because now you have a lot.
I have a lot to say, right?
All right.
Save my poor voice. Okay, are there any council members who want to pull anything from the consent agenda? Okay, seeing none. I will read this. I move to adopt the following consent agenda items. Item A, number 1, construction contract. Number 2, supplement. Number 4, for construction management services, water tank modifications and repairs. Number 1, authorize the mayor to enter into and execute on behalf of the city a contract with T. Bailey, Inc. of Anacortes, Washington, for the construction of the water tank modifications and repairs 2013 project in the amount not to exceed $1,403,683.01, including sales tax. Item 2 under this is authorize the mayor to enter into and execute on behalf of the city a contract supplement with RH2 Engineering of Bothell, Washington, for on-call engineering support and construction management in an amount not to exceed $161,700, which includes a management reserve of 10%. Sales tax does not apply. Item B, final acceptance, citywide safety improvements. Authorize the mayor to approve the final acceptance of the work performed under the contract for the citywide safety improvement project, subject to the requirements of appropriate state and federal agencies, if any, and ultimately release of the retention to the contractor. The total contractor payment is $275,843.88. Item C, final acceptance, contract 1929, Recreation Center Renovation Project. Authorize the mayor to approve the final acceptance of the work performed under the contract for the Recreation Center Renovation Project, subject to the requirements of appropriate state and federal agencies, if any, and ultimate release of the retention to the contractor, if any. Item D, contract award, wastewater treatment plant headworks electrical replacement. Authorize the mayor to enter into and execute on behalf of the city a contract with Dutton Electric Company, Inc. of Mukilteo, Washington, to replace electrical panels in the WWTP wastewater treatment plant for amount of $181,960 plus tax. Item E, interlocal agreement extension, interurban trail. Authorize the mayor to execute the extension of the interlocal agreement with Snohomish County for the Small Capital Projects Partnership to provide a new expiration date of December 31st, 2017. Item F, interlocal agreement, consolation of administration function. Authorize the mayor to execute amendment number 1 to the interlocal agreement for consolidation of administrative functions between Snohomish County Fire Protection District number 1 and the City of Lynnwood, effective July 11, 2016. Item G, interlocal agreement 2822, biosolid disposal, City of Edmonds. Authorize the mayor to execute an interlocal agreement with the City of Edmonds for biosolids treatment and disposal as needed for 5 years, with 2 additional 2-year options. Item H, confirmation Planning Commission applicant Robin Taylor. Confirm appointment of Robin Taylor to position number 5 of the Planning Commission to serve remaining term of open position number 5, expiring December 31st, 2019. Item I, budget planning calendar for 2017. Adopt resolution 2017-04, a resolution of the City of Lynnwood, Washington, adopting the 2017 budget planning calendar in accordance with Chapter 2.72 of the Lynnwood Municipal Code. And finally, item J, voucher approval. Approve claims and payroll in the amount of $2,121,238.79 and $1,295,967.77, respectively.
That was a lot.
Yeah, it was.
Our consent agenda will be approved as read. Thank you. Moving on to 90.3, our other business items. Let's see, we have 1, 2, 3, 4 to deal with tonight. There's no executive session. So A is to remove police chief and fire chief from civil service. Is there someone who'd like to take that one? Council President?
Can I get an ordinance number, please?
3245.
3245. I move that we, the City Council of the City of Lynnwood, Washington, one moment here. I already forgot it.
You forgot it?
3245.
Right. Okay. trying to use technology. Ian needs to teach you how to take notes.
There again. I move that we, the City Council of the City of Lynnwood, Washington, adopt ordinance number 3245, an ordinance of the City Council of the City of Lynnwood, Washington, relating to the city's police and fire civil service, amending LMC 2.56.010 and LMC 2.56.030, and providing for severability and effective date and summary publication.
Second. Thank you. Would you like to speak to that?
A little bit, yes. But what I would like to do more so than speak is invite any members of the Civil Service Commission that we have here to come up to the podium that are willing or would like to speak to this ordinance and what it means to them on the Civil Service Commission. So I invited Lauren Simmons and Ed Dos Remedios. He's not here. Ed is not here yet. He said he would try and make it if he could. And Lauren said that he'd be happy to share some thoughts. So please.
Well, first of all, Council President, members of the City Council, and Mayor Smith, I'm not particularly happy to do this. I'm going to do it. But I was expecting to be the second or third speaker because, as you may be aware, since you confirmed my appointment earlier, I have been on the Civil Service Commission, I think, barely 90 days. So I am the junior member. Mr. Gary Lemming, I think, is the senior member and has been on for quite a number of years. And one of my earlier colleagues on the council, Mr. Ed Dos Remedios, is currently the president elect as of January of the Civil Service Commission. There are two or three things that I think are really important to share with you by way of introduction in light of the fact that my other colleagues are not here. And you can feel free to confirm these items before I guess, say my two or three points. First of all, did the commission know that the administration was looking to remove the positions of police and fire chief from under the umbrella of civil service? I cannot speak for the other two gentlemen because we have not had conversation. I will say, however, I was aware that it could be brought forth at some point in time, nothing specific. My awareness goes back to when I was on the council and council president with actually a prior administration who brought that to the surface as a point in time. Number two, did the commission discuss this possibility at any of their meetings? It has not been discussed on any agenda since I've been on the commission, and you would have to search prior meeting agendas or talk with other commissioners to confirm that, but not since I've been on the commission. Number three, do I have any personal concerns about moving the police and fire chief from under the umbrella of civil service? I'm going to zero in on the word concern, and I'm going to say to you, I don't know that I have concerns, because I imply in that word a degree of gravity or seriousness, but I do have several questions that I would pose for you as the decision makers, whether you do that this evening or whether you elect to postpone your decision and discuss it further. My first issue, I guess, from my personal perspective, and again, I'm not speaking for the commission because we have not discussed this, okay? We all understand that. The first relates to timing. If you approve the measure before you tonight and the mayor makes a formal appointment soon, you must remember that she, in a matter of weeks or a few months, will be in the midst of a re-election process. You may, by making the decision now, open the city up to rapid changes in two of the most significant positions in the short amount of time. There's an underlying assumption there, is that if she is re-elected, that's one issue. If she is not, and she's made a decision, the person that would replace her in that office would have the same authority, and you could have a very fast turnaround time if there was some degree of disagreement with her particular selection. Number two, with a pending vote on the RFA scheduled for August, what is the impact of this decision, especially on the fire department leadership in the near future? Quite candidly, I don't know the answer to that. That may be something that the city attorney can help you with, but depending on how that goes, the whole issue revolving who will be the fire chief and how he or she is selected and what happens after the first year and those sorts of things. Again, I just share that with you by way of feeling that it is important that you may think through those issues beforehand. Number C, moving the two positions from out underneath the umbrella of civil service, in my opinion, will definitely politicize the positions and impact the stability of the departments, or at least I think that's a very real risk that you take. I don't have a lot of data for communities the size of Lynnwood, but I have read enough in some of the major newspapers and magazines and whatever that I can tell you that where this process that is being proposed is operational, that the turnover, particularly in the police department, is really quite frequent. And by that, I'm saying anywhere from 3 to 5 years. And that does concern me. And the last thing I guess I would say, is this a matter that you might want the input from the citizens of Lynnwood on an advisory vote? Not very frequently do I make that suggestion, because if you do that and you get an answer that you don't like, you can run high risk by ignoring what the voters have said. Having said that, I am not assuming anything, particularly since I haven't had any conversations with my colleagues. But I would say to you that I don't think this is a decision that you dare take lightly, because I do think it has far-reaching implications. And I'm sure you want to make the very best decision. So I can only, I guess, appeal to you with the question, have you thought this through as thoroughly as you should or that you want to before you cast your vote? Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Simmons. In light of that, I don't necessarily have much else that I would speak to. I do share some of the same concerns and issues that were brought up. Over the last week to 10 days, in reading over the information and speaking with the mayor and listening to what Lauren Simmons just, the information he's given us and some of his thoughts, I think I would be in favor of possibly postponing this vote instead of doing it this evening and getting more information. Because one of the concerns that I do have was recently just brought to light. I didn't necessarily think about some of the things that were brought up. And so I think there's more discussion that could be had. And that's kind of where I am now on this matter.
Councilmember Sessions.
Thank you. At last week's work session, I brought up a few concerns. I was one of the only council members who brought up some different concerns. I only say that because up here you got to pick your battles. And, you know, if I were to think, if there was an option to postpone it tonight, I would be in favor of that. With that said, if it's not postponed, I do know how I'm going to vote. But I do still have some other questions. And I did a lot of the work on my own before last work session, and then again since then, as far as looking more into this. One thing I want to repeat, like Lauren Simmons mentioned, I was a little concerned last week with some of the council members' comments about this because I think it was taken too lightly. It's a lot more complicated than we were giving, or some people were giving credit to it. It's not a simple change in job or things like that. This isn't that situation. There is a lot more complexity to it. I also want to be sure again to say that this is, we are not out of compliance. We're not doing anything wrong by keeping the fire chief and the police chief under the civil service. There's nothing wrong with keeping it like that. But I do understand the reasons the mayor and the HR director want to change it. It's not consistent to other things and other ways that people around here do things. I totally get that. Also, I want to be clear that, you know, if I could guarantee that that we would have our mayor again for another 4 years and we would still have our potential chief, Chief Davis, it'd be simple for me. But there's no guarantees. And again, because it could be used as a political pawn, that's what makes me nervous, that again, it could be changed and then it could, you know, there'd be a problem. So with all that said, I still have a couple questions, and a couple questions that were answered for me this week weren't very clear. Also, I wanted to mention that it's true. Last week, I'd mentioned that I thought that this wasn't a good timing, because we had interim chiefs, but I do want to change that. I think that I agree with a lot of my members here that if we are going to do this, right now is the time to do it with both interim chiefs, with us having interim chiefs. So. I do change my opinion on that big time. I do know that the Guild, and we mentioned it last week, that the Guild president wrote us a letter in favor of Chief Davis. And a little side note, my concerns about the civil service change has nothing to do with Chief Davis. I think he's a great chief, and I think he should be our chief as well, so that's not a problem. But the Guild did give us a letter encouraging us to hire the chief officially, which is good news to have your whole Guild, staff, commanders, everybody agree on that. That's pretty telling. In there, in one sentence towards the bottom, they briefly did mention that they were also in favor of taking the chiefs, particularly they were just talking about their chief, out of civil service. And last week that was mentioned, but I want to be clear that in that letter, it was with the caveat that they keep Chief Davis as the chief. It was not, to say that they blanketed that and said it could be anybody do that, you know, take the chiefs out of civil service and just hire anybody, that would be disingenuous to say that, because that was not what I believe the intent of that was in that letter. So one of the questions I had, and Lauren Simmons kind of brought this up too, I think one way that would really help me be comfortable with this is if we voted for this to take them out of civil service, Mayor, would you bargain a contract with them, with the chiefs? Would you bargain a contract with them instead of being in civil service?
So that's a second step, and that's something we can discuss as we post the job. Christine, Director Scarlett, was going to start collecting and seeing what other cities have done with regard to contracts. So it's certainly up for discussion.
Because I'd be afraid to vote for that if we didn't already know that you were willing to do a contract, I guess, is part of it, mm-hmm. is part of my concern. And then if we were not, if the council, you know, majority agreed still to remove them and not bargain a contract with them, then I would suggest that there be a fairly significant severance package for them if they were removed for no cause. Of course, I'm all in favor for removing people for cause, but removing a chief for no cause, I know, Mayor, you mentioned 3 months possibly of pay. I don't think that's enough to prevent a different mayor or somebody, you know, in the future to get rid of our chiefs for no cause. I think it needs to be 6 months or more severance pay, because I think that would make it less likely for somebody to willy-nilly change the plan. Also, just to answer towards the discussion about possibly bringing it to the vote of the public, I'm not really in favor of that. I think this is something we can all really decide on, but I would like a couple answers of that. And I don't know, Mayor, if you're able to answer those since Director Scarlett's not here, but just to about as far as bargaining a contract and or changing the severance pay package, if it's an at-will position. And so I'd like to hear that. But like I said, last week it was very evident that there is a majority of the council who was going to pass this, so I wouldn't pick my battles and trying to fight over it at this point. But I am still concerned and would like those answers. Thank you.
Thank you. Councilmember Cotton.
Thank you, Your Honor. A couple questions for City Attorney Larson. One is, under the civil service arrangements now, what's the process for the mayor to say, not that she wouldn't, is just exploring hypotheticals to kind of maybe explore some of these concerns. Right now, if the mayor finds need to put one of these chiefs on administrative leave pending some kind of civil service action, can she essentially send them on their way for a period of time until such time as, how does that process work?
I am not an expert at your civil service rules, I'm sorry. But I do, it is my understanding that there's a process that you have to go through to do that.
Okay, so under the current arrangement, the mayor cannot just summarily send someone on leave or?
No, there's rules that need to be followed.
Okay. And then also just from a standpoint of the police, as in a strong mayor government, the chief enforcement officer of the law in the city is the mayor, is that correct?
Well, yes. Technically, that's correct. The mayor is the head of the city.
Mm-hmm. I mean, the chief is the enforcer, but ultimately they report to the mayor.
They report to the mayor.
Yeah, okay. Okay, I think those are a few of my questions. You know, I've kind of gotten myself up to speed on this because, quite honestly, for the first year I was on council, I didn't really know what the Civil Service Council did or commission did. I was kind of like, oh, we've got that. It seems like a protection that has been told to us is a definitely an atypical condition. And we've heard from a former council member, Mr. Heichel, who knows some of the history on how that happened. So it probably explains some of the atypical nature of why Lynnwood is the only jurisdiction of like jurisdictions and comparables that has this current arrangement. There was another element, though, I think Director Scarlett did inform us of, that part of this ordinance does, so there's no compliance issue with the chiefs, but I believe we do have a compliance issue with one of the unions and represented bodies in the police department. So, and I don't know how to wordsmith those out of compliant elements in or out of this. So I think for me, given that this is an atypical situation, you know, I would be in support of moving forward on this. If a majority of the council wants to postpone for further investigation, I'm okay with that too. I don't really have a dog in this fight, but I do want to bring up the point that we are kind of out of compliance with an element of our civil service organizationally that this is meant to rectify. And I'm comfortable both hearing from the police union president and also from our human resource director that this is an atypical situation that is kind of in the realm of city administration. This is kind of an atypical, non-conforming condition. We can always, I think, run through scenarios in our head where, you know, we could use this over that. But I think for the general flow of city administration and for the equitability between departments, I think that this is probably the right path to go on. So, thanks.
Councilmember Hurst.
Thank you. The only reason I hesitate on this is I really would like to hear from the Civil Service Commission as a body to give us some sort of recommendation. All my employment has been in the private industry, and you know, I haven't dealt in the civil service realm, but I believe Councilmember Sessions has, and because you know, Attorney Larson is not sure, and I heard actually HR Director Scarlett was not sure of some of the civil service rules, and in particular, I talked to the chair president of the Civil Service Commission. He wasn't aware of the positions that were out of compliance, and so he doesn't even has not been made aware of this. So I think maybe postponing it would not be a bad decision. I think I would like to have it postponed so we can just get a little more information. Thank you.
Commissioner Ed Dos Remedios has joined us. Would you like to come and share your thoughts as a civil service commissioner with us?
Good evening, Mrs. Mayor, Council Chair Goodwin, and the rest of the council members. I guess I'll answer any questions you have. Personally, I was asked if I was in favor or opposed to removing the two chiefs from Civil Service Commission. From a personal standpoint, matters to me not one bit, quite frankly. If that's what the way you choose to go, that's the way you choose to go. But I am a little bothered with some of the comments that were made about compliance. We're out of compliance, this, that, and the other. I asked for a list of the jobs that the positions that were supposedly out of compliance. I got those this morning. I haven't had a chance to look at them because I've been tied up all day. And as far as I'm concerned, from the Civil Service Commission, the Lynnwood rules and regulations do not include any of the positions that were on that list. And I guess in a nutshell, the Civil Service Commission only addresses and caters to uniformed personnel. So if we're talking about the clerks, this, that, and the other, they're not covered under the Civil Service Commission, not in the city of Lynnwood. But they are covered from the chief down to the patrolman and the chief down to the firefighter. So if compliance is an issue, I would say we need to do a little more research on that, because I believe the information you received is absolutely wrong and incorrect. And also, I heard on last Tuesday that all the Civil Service Commission does and chartered to do is oversee the hiring process. Well, that's not true. We handle grievances, we handle appeals, and we handle any other differences other than union contracts. So that's more to it than meets the eye, and I think that's more to it than was disclosed last Tuesday. So having said that, I'll answer any questions you may have, but fire away.
Councilmember Ross.
Rosemary, help me with an amendment to the motion to postpone this matter to the next business meeting.
You could make a motion to postpone consideration of this ordinance to the next work session or the next regular business meeting, whatever your
desire
is.
Well, I would like it to go to a work session before it comes to a business meeting. But I don't know, do we have to do date specific if we table this or postpone it?
Well, I have heard the council do it such that they direct the council president to put it on the next available work session agenda.
I would make that motion.
Second.
Any discussion?
I still have discussion. Do I have to discuss only on the amendment, or can I still discuss what
just
we were talking
amendment.
About?
Just
so I
the
can
amendment.
Talk about something else after?
Yes.
Okay. Okay, no discussion then.
All those in favor of postponing this for future discussion at a work session, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposition? All right. Now what do we do with our first motion?
You've just postponed it to the next available
okay.
work
so
session
we don't have
meeting.
To cancel it or
hold
anything
it for
all
the
right.
next time.
Okay. Yep. Councilmember Session, you had
yes.
a question for Ed?
Yes. Thank you for your information, Ed, about the being out of compliance. Again, I want to just be clear that the piece regarding the two chiefs being taken out of civil service is not the part, just for the viewers, that's not the part that's out of compliance, not at all. They're referring to the possibility that since this is support services staff at the police department wasn't part of civil service, that potentially that's the question, is whether or not that part is out of compliance. And the support services staff, all of them, as far as I remember, they're all non-commissioned personnel. And so maybe that's the sticking point where all the others are commissioned, even limited and full commission.
Yeah, the city of Lynnwood rules and regulations as far as Civil Service Commission quite clearly states the classifications that are included in the civil service. And quite clearly the support staff are not. It goes from the chief down to firefighter, chief down to the patrol person. And I forgot to mention this, but I think you were discussing the protection that the chiefs may have under one system or another. There are protections afforded to the police fire chief and the police chief, because termination for cause has to be for cause. It can't be arbitrary, and serving at the pleasure of does not really apply in these two particular cases. So there are other considerations too, so I hope that answers your question.
It does. Thank you very much.
Councilmember Cotton.
Thank you, Your Honor. I just want to thank both of our commissioners who are here tonight for coming and giving us some of the knowledge, since you're in the trenches doing the work. So appreciate that. Definitely was informative, and it sounds like, I don't know, council leadership, if you could work with the commission and our director of HR to try and sort this thing out so that at the work session we get a clear understanding, because it seems like we're maybe needing to be brought up to speed from a department standpoint on what's going on. So thank you.
Anything else? Okay. All right. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
All right, let's move on to 90.3B. This is an ordinance to repeal LMC Chapter 2.58, Neighborhoods and Demographic Diversity Commissions. Councilmember Cotton.
Thank you, Your Honor.
3246.
3246, okay. I would move the adoption of ordinance number 3246, an ordinance of the City Council of the City of Lynnwood, Washington, repealing Chapter 2.58 LMC, dissolving the Neighborhoods and Demographic Diversity Advisory Commission, providing for severability and effective date and summary publication.
Second.
Would you like to speak to that?
Yeah, I think, you know, as I've gotten up to speed on the history of this commission and having been the liaison for a year there, I know that I think that this commission suffered post-recession elements where there was once an actual whole department of the city dedicated to supporting this commission. And in the recession, we very responsibly said, what can we afford? And that entire department is still codified. However, it is unfunded, and so it does not exist in the real world. And so I think this commission suffered from that. I think also Lynnwood has changed. I think that when this commission was originally created, I think Lynnwood as a community was still grappling with the fact of if we were or were not a diverse community. And I think that we have since awakened to the fact that we are, in fact, a very diverse community. And so after this, we'll be moving another ordinance to create a new commission, which I believe, in tandem with the Human Services Commission, will better further the work that essentially this commission has done. And this commission has done a great job. I'd personally like to thank the commissioners I worked with as the liaison, Rabbi Patiel, Ty Tufono, Angel Shalimish, Glenda Powell Freeman, Penning Reyes, and Rosa Maria Graziani, who all, and currently on council now, but Shirley Sutton also was part of that commission, and served our community dutifully, passionately. There were some extremely successful Black History Month outings and events, and really some very inclusive and focused events that were able to be executed as part of this commission. But I think the time has come to embrace the fact that we are a diverse community and move on to better shepherding that with new legislation. So that's all for me.
Any other comments? We'll have a roll call, please.
Mm-hmm. Council Vice President Ross?
Yes.
Councilmember Hurst?
Yes.
Councilmember Sessions?
Yes.
Councilmember Sutton?
Yes.
Councilmember Boyer?
Aye.
Councilmember Cotton?
Yes.
Council President Goodwin?
Affirmative.
Seven yes, Mayor.
Thank you. So 90.3C is our ordinance to establish the Diversity, Equity, and Inclusion Commission. Councilmember Cotton?
Thank you very much, Your Honor. I move the adoption of ordinance number 3247, an ordinance of the City Council of the City of Lynnwood, Washington, establishing a Diversity, Equity, and Inclusion Commission, adding a new chapter 2.60 to the Lynnwood Municipal Code, providing for severability and effective date and summary publication.
Second.
Would you like to speak to this one?
Yes, this is kind of, I think, the natural evolution of us moving away from recognizing and trying to identify what our, that we have diversity, to now we're saying we are a diverse community. How do we include that diversity? How do we cross all those lines that exist? And how do we more completely and equitably bring everyone together around the table in the city? So I'm very excited about the work that many on council did to make this happen, and many work of those in the community to make this happen. So
thank you. Would anyone, yeah, Councilmember Hurst.
I'd like to make a motion to amend this ordinance, just on a housekeeping type of change on page C90.3C4, lines 43 and 44. I would like to delete these lines, which call for, says a commission position shall automatically become vacant if the commissioner fails to attend 3 regular meetings in a 12-month period. I do believe we're trying to make sure all the commissions are on the same
rules. Yes. So,
I would second that amendment.
Okay.
All those in favor, please say aye.
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 Thank you. Thank you for catching that.
Yeah.
Julie's back there nodding her head, so you got it. Any other discussion? Roll call, please.
Okay. Council Vice President Ross?
Yes.
Councilmember Sessions?
Yes.
Councilmember Sutton?
Yes.
Councilmember Boyer?
Aye.
Councilmember Cotton?
Yes.
Council President Goodwin?
Affirmative.
Councilmember Hurst?
Aye.
7 yes, Mayor.
Thank you. And then finally, 90.3D, this is our ordinance, boards and commission LMC revisions. Councilmember Hurst, do you want to do this?
Oh, okay.
Oh.
Okay.
Councilmember Boyer, you're ready to go?
You okay?
All right.
Yes, and before we get too far down the road, I would say to my colleagues that the sharp-eyed among you no doubt noted that there were actually two ordinances appended to our packet here. The first ordinance with all the redlining was appended in error, a clerical error. The ordinance we're actually looking at tonight, which I assume will be number 3248, begins on page 90.3D17. The other paperwork is from an ordinance that was, in fact, adopted by City Council, yeah, some months ago. So skip that. Jump over to 90.3D17. And I would move the council approve ordinance number 3248, an ordinance of the City of Lynnwood, Washington, relating to the city's boards and commissions, amending chapters 2.24, 2.28, 2.30, and 2.47 of the Lynnwood Municipal Code, and providing for severability, an effective date, and summary publication.
Second. Second.
And would you like to speak any more to that?
I think we should have let George have the first word.
I think it was. Thank you. Councilmember Sessions?
Thank you for everybody's work on this. I just wanted to say again out loud that we would love the chairs of all these different commissions and boards and staff liaisons and council liaisons to be sure that they clearly educate all the current and future volunteers appointed to these boards and commissions, just to be sure they understand the new expectations. Thank you. Thank you, Julie.
Council President?
Thank you. It was brought up earlier about the lack of opportunity for people to serve on the commissions consecutively or more than 2 terms. And actually, just want to quickly read G, which says, each person appointed by the City Council may serve no more than 2 consecutive terms, provided that a person appointed to fill an unexpired term of less than 2 years is eligible to serve 2 successive full terms. And provided further, a person who is ineligible to serve for having served 2 consecutive terms may again serve after 1 year has elapsed from the end of the second such term. So what we're really doing is, as Councilmember Hurst mentioned earlier in his comments, is trying to give people that have served on these boards and commissions for a number of years, try and give them a break. And one of the reasons is oftentimes, if you've served on different boards and commissions, you tend to have a feeling that the expertise you have is needed far more than your break is needed. And so the opportunity to give yourself that break, you really don't want to do that. And it's we're allowing that opportunity. Secondly, is it gives, during that period of time, someone else from the community an opportunity to serve in that commission or board and bring fresh ideas and help out. This is something that Councilmember Boyer has championed for quite a while, and I think it's a good idea. And as Councilmember Hurst mentioned earlier, that it's something I think will help out the boards and commissions as we move and progress and allow new and fresh ideas into the boards and commissions.
Councilmember Hurst.
Great. Yeah, I just would like to thank, past president of the council, Boyer, who formed a task force to look at boards and commissions, get some consistency. I know Julie Moore did a lot of work on this. Thank you. And we're just trying to get better mm-hmm. at this. And I appreciate all the work that was done. Thank you.
Anybody else? All right, we'll take the roll call, please.
Councilmember Sessions?
Yes.
Councilmember Sutton?
Yes.
Councilmember Boyer?
Aye.
Councilmember Cotton?
Affirmative.
Council President Goodwin?
Yep.
Councilmember Hurst?
Me? Aye.
Council Vice President Roth?
Yes.
7 yes, Mayor.
Thank you. All right, as I said, no executive session. I don't think there's any new business. Yes, Councilmember?
Move to adjourn.
Oh, well, there you have it. That's awesome. Not new. Second. All right. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Thank you for this evening.